Good afternoon or good evening to you. I'd just like to advise you that the meeting is being recorded and there will be a version of it for you to be able to watch after the meeting if you miss anything or if you have to leave the meeting for any reason. I'd like to extend a sort of warm welcome to TWI members. I believe there are quite a few that have registered to join the webinar. We're very grateful. And also to the non-members who are joining the webinar today. Obviously, the webinar is entitled The Development of a Rapid Timber Joining Technique. I'm joined by two co-hosts today. We've got Dr. Kate Franklin, who is a senior project leader at TWI, and Dr. Darshil Shah with us today as well from the University of Cambridge. And Darshil is a lecturer in the Department of Architecture. I'm sure they will give us more information shortly on where they're at. Couple of points that... Sorry, Kate, can you just start the... or can I control it from here? Decided to... Thank you. Couple of points, couple of tips that we'd like to go over before we actually get into the webinar proper is get yourself comfortable and get a beverage of your choice. I'm drinking good old healthy water. make sure you've got your microphones muted, although they should be by default, I think, when you join the webinar. Remove any distractions such as, you know, iPods, phones, et cetera, et cetera. That'll be good, unless, of course, you're watching the webinar on it, which wouldn't be good. And if you've got any questions, great, we welcome those questions. We'd ask you to use the Q&A function, which you should be able to access. I think it's at the bottom of the screen. Obviously, we'll aim to sort of answer those questions at the end of the webinar. rest assured, if you ask a question and we don't have the time to answer it at the end of the webinar, we obviously are recording the questions as well, and we will get back to you in due course after the webinar. We'll be back in contact with you. And as I said at the beginning, you know, there will also be a link of the recording of this webinar, which will be distributed to all the registered attendees as well. So what I'd like to do first of all is for those who aren't familiar with TWI, and I do appreciate perhaps, you know, because of the application we're talking about at the moment, quite a few people might not be familiar with TWI. I'd like to give you a little bit of an overview of who we are and what we are, and also, of course, where we are and what we do. So we are, as the slide says, we're a research and technology organization, an RTO. We are a membership-driven organization. You're basically working with the TWI. Membership is a requirement. Obviously, that membership has numerous benefits, of which we'd be more than happy to go into on perhaps a different meeting at a later stage, if that is of interest to you. But you know, as a rule, we're actually currently serving around about 800 industrial members, and as you can see from the slide, those are spread all over the world. Obviously, you know, we have quite a large membership in the UK, but as it says, you know, there are approximately 4,500 sites across 80 countries worldwide. We count a lot of very big global companies within our membership, and we'd be talking companies like Boeing, BMW, sort of Shell, Rolls Royce, but right the way down to SMEs and smaller companies. So we work with a broad spectrum of companies, and we also work across a broad spread of sectors. We've tended to work a lot in the oil and gas sector historically, but you know, in recent years that has diversified and we're working a lot in other areas as well. We are, as it says, not-for-profit distributing. Essentially, as I said, it's very much an organization which is driven by its membership. When you join TWI, a percentage of your membership goes back into what we call the CRP, or the Course Research Program. We have approximately 750 staff globally. Quite a few of those are based in the UK, but then, as I've also said, we have offices dotted around the globe, and in those offices are obviously staff supporting training and other activities as well. And it's important to say that, to underline that cross-sector innovation, because of the range of technologies that we deal with at TWI, it obviously appeals to a lot of different sectors, we'll perhaps touch on some of those in a bit. So as we've said, we're focused out of the UK. The headquarters there, which in fact is where I'm based, and it's also where Kate currently is. As is probably with a lot of people, some of us are working from home at the moment because of the current situation. But it's important to underline that, for instance, at our facility in Cambridge, where it's obviously safe and proper to do so, we are continuing to work as much as we can as normal. So the labs are all still working, etc. And I think Darshil is probably in Cambridge as well at the moment. So that's where we're based. And Cambridge is effectively the headquarters. So I'm not going to go into minute detail of all of the different sites there, but you can see we are spread across the UK. For instance, if we look at the Aberdeen site, I already mentioned that we do a lot of work with oil and gas, for instance. And obviously from the UK, that is a key centre for oil and gas. So we have a training centre and NDT, inspection and welding expertise there as well. So what do we do? Well, we are TWI, the Welding Institute, was set up in 1946. And because of the name, people automatically think of us for welding and joining. And, you know, that's absolutely fair enough. We certainly want that. We don't want to change people's opinion there, but we actually do so much more. We have diversified into so many different areas and so many different technologies over the years. So yes, we do joining. Yes, we do surfacing. We do testing, inspection, training, and a lot of other things, even welding wood, which we'll talk to you about in a short while. I touched upon the core research program that we have. We're very, very focused on innovation and development. So we'll show you a little timeline shortly of what TWI has been involved with since its inception. I guess one thing that I would like to highlight would be friction stir welding, which is a technology that was invented by TWI and has been developed since then. And that's been a very, very important technology for use, for instance, in the electrification, the EV market. It's used for battery technology, etc. So, and obviously it's used in aerospace and a wide variety of different applications. So I'm very proud of the fact that we've invented technologies like that, and the fact that we continue to innovate with technologies. So TWI has a wealth of knowledge and experience, a lot of very clever people, a lot of people very, very focused in their field of expertise. And as a result of that, we work with companies where we're looking at products from sort of inception right the way through to production. And we work, it's important to underline, for instance, we also work closely, we have in membership a lot of the suppliers of the equipment that companies will use to go on and manufacture the products that we're helping them develop. Obviously, we also count qualification, certification, training that I've touched upon, and even on occasion we will get involved in production as well. Where it's right and proper to do so, and where we can't offer that service via one of our members. So that's a little bit of a timeline there, really covering the 70 years or so of the innovation in materials joining an inspection that we've had at TWI. A few points that we'd highlight there is, as I've already said, it's friction stir welding, electron sculpting, right the way up to 2020, we've been working with things like data transmission through composite structures, which is a really, really exciting prospect as well. Thanks, Kate. Okay. So the two speakers that we've got today, very, very pleased to introduce you to Dr. Kate Franklin. As I said, Kate is a senior project leader in our friction and forge processes section. I mean, just to give you an idea, my name, by the way, sorry, I should have said this at the beginning, is Nick McCarthy, and I'm a business development manager for the Advanced Manufacturing Technologies Group at TWI. And one within that group, we have several sections. One of those sections is friction and forge processes. And Kate works within that section. Kate studied at the University of Birmingham and also has a PhD in structural metallic systems for gas turbine applications, which was sponsored by Rolls-Royce. And obviously, as you can see, Darshil, who I'm sure will introduce himself as well, but is a lecturer in the Department of Architecture at Cambridge. And I know has a number of other strings to his bow as well, which I'm sure he'll tell us about shortly. So I think I'm going to hand over to Kate now, who is perhaps going to give us a bit of background in the technology that we're using, the process that we're using, the established technology that we're using for this process. So over to you, Kate. Thank you.
Thanks, Nick. So, yeah, as Nick said, I'm Kate Franklin. I'm working here at TWI. In fact, this is the first day I've been in the office for 6 months now. So it's a very exciting time day for me. So when I normally tell people that I work in welding, they often think that I wear like a mask and have a little torch like in flash dance, and I have to disappoint them pretty quickly. So my PhD and my work here at TWI is focused on friction welding. So just a little bit of what is friction welding and how are we using that to join timber? Okay, so in this instance, we're utilizing linear friction welding, which is essentially rubbing two parts together. So holding one static and rubbing it. So there's in metal, there's no melting involved. The temperatures remain really low, which means that it's a highly controlled process, a mechanical process that's got really high repeatability, no melting. And there's a few variables with that. So we can obviously, we can change how long we run that process for, the frequency and the oscillation of the movement, and the pressure, so how hard we push those two parts together. And I'll explain a bit more about the process in a later slide. But I just want to highlight the applications, where this is used and what the advantages are. Okay, so friction welding is normally used in safety critical applications, where high quality is really imperative. So like I did my PhD with Rolls-Royce, that was on friction welding in aerospace engines. And an example of that here is blisks. So you linear friction weld the blades to the larger disc. You can also, it's also been used in rail and chain applications. And here I've used an example of a wing rib to demonstrate its use to produce near net shape components, where you're adding something to a thinner part to allow you to reduce the machining on that part. So it's an established mature technology. It's used traditionally and in traditionally conservative industrial areas, so such as aerospace, in planes, rail, and it tends to be used for safety critical components that require the highest engineering demands. So essentially it's the best type of joint, or at least I like to think so. So what are its key advantages? And here I've tried to pick out advantages that I think are key in metallic applications that we normally work in, but also translate very well into wood and what we think will be important using this in the timber industry. So it's incredibly fast. So it takes just a matter of seconds to join the parts. Initial trials that we've done on wood have all taken less than 10 seconds. And Darshil will talk a bit more about the best times, but they're very, very quick. And even the entire process as a whole, including moving parts in and out, can be fully automated and therefore just take just a matter of seconds. So in terms of wood, this also means that there's no curing time, and we're reducing labour costs and time by automating the process. It's highly repeatable. So it's known for its repeatability. Every joint produced is almost identical. And due to the removal of any human influence, it results in very low defect rates. Okay, so thirdly, the process doesn't require any additional material. So in metal, that means that we don't use a filler wire or flux, and we don't need a shielding gas. In timber, that means that we don't need any adhesives, so no glue, no solvents, and there's no need for any mechanical fasteners. So you're removing any additional metal or plastic or any other component that you might use in a joint. It's just timber to timber. And we think that this could reduce the environmental impact of products, as well as reducing the production time and cost. And finally, it's a near net shape. It can be used to produce near net shape components. So as I mentioned previously, this can be allow you to reduce manufacturing costs compared to machining from solid. It reduces material wastage and reduces the cost of materials as a whole. Okay, so what is linear friction welding? So I mentioned previously that it's essentially just rubbing two parts together and that there's no melting involved. So it's generally termed a solid state joining process, and that's because metallic materials in metallic materials, the friction is used to heat the interface and allow plastic deformation and mechanical mixing, but not melting. And in linear friction welding, that heating is achieved through the application of pressure and a linear oscillating motion. So as you can see in the schematic on the screen and in the video, one part is held still and they're brought together under an axial force. One of the parts is then linearly oscillated while the other remains stationary. And finally, the oscillation ceases and a forging axial force is applied. So they're pushed together, essentially. They're held together under a force once that motion's stopped. And the process is completed in a matter of seconds. So here is a video of linear friction welding using titanium, and it produces a joint in just 4 seconds. You get full consolidation. Now, I can see a perfect video in front of me that looks incredible, but I'm aware that due to bandwidth constraints, you might not be able to see the same quality video that I'm seeing. So these videos are available to view on YouTube. And we'll send the links out to those, and there's some information on the last slide. Okay, so over time at TDY, we've welded a wide range of materials together using this technique. So we've looked at metals, refractory metals, polymers, ceramics, composites, and we've also used the same machine to do testing on rocks, and we've even joined chocolate together. All of these have had successful results, so we had to work out where to go next, and the latest thing we've tried is timber. So again, this is the same machine, and exactly the same process, but now we're using it to join beech. Again, the video might not be as good quality on your screen as it is on mine, but you can see that the process remains incredibly fast with excellent tolerances. So the part at the end is in exactly the perfect position that you would want it to be. And you can see at the end of the process, there is some smoke, but no fire. And so we think we've proved the proverb wrong. We've been really impressed with the initial results. It's produced a very strong joint. And as you'll, Darshil will explain a little bit more about the strength and the surface. Okay, so what about other materials? So we've not just welded beech, we've investigated other different species of wood and wood composites, including MDF and particle board. I actually have some examples on my desk. So here is particle board. Now I'm aware that that is got a high polymer content. So that welds a lot more similarly to other polymers and metallic materials. We've also got an example here of oak. Now this is, I think, 100 years old oak, I'm told. And on this part, you can actually see the damage here. I don't know if you can see me on the screen or just the presentation, but there's damage to the part where we've tried to pull the joint apart and it's failed in the fixture rather than in the joint itself. Okay, so just to note that some examples shown here and some examples that you may find if you search for joining of wood in literature, they tend to use a different frequency domain. So you might use vibration friction welding rather than linear friction welding. And we've had improved results using linear friction welding. So far, we've mostly looked at hardwood and produced great results. We don't currently know why these parts are joining so well, and that's why we're working with Cambridge University to investigate the mechanisms at play. So that is where I'd like to pass you over to Dr. Darshil Shah.
Thank you, Kate. Thank you, Nick. Yes, it's been a fantastic journey working with the TWI. They are clearly the experts on this manufacturing process, linear friction welding that we are using. Our expertise at the Department of Architecture in the Center for Natural Material Innovation lies with the material in this case, particularly timber. So I'll start off by introducing our center, but do remind me that I also have some samples to show if I forget. So I'm at the Center for Natural Material Innovation, where we work with a range of plant-based materials, primarily for the construction and building sector, but also for a range of other engineering applications, such as looking at natural fibers, like flax, linen, and hemp for wind energy or aerospace and automotive components. For example, at the back over there, there's an automotive panel part that is made from flax composites. But timber and bamboo are materials that we use for more mass scale applications, particularly in the building and construction industry. Our center is multidisciplinary. We work across a range of departments from plant sciences and biochemistry, where our colleagues and scientists work at the very small scale. So looking at how cellulose, the basic building block of timber, forms and how it arranges with the other cell wall polymers and how wood gets its properties. We also work at the tissue scale with colleagues in chemistry and mathematics and physics, for example, looking at how polymers may be impregnated into wood to enhance the mechanical performance and the durability of wood. And this is both to look at the applications of timbers and engineered timbers in building and construction, but also to explore how we may be able to preserve national treasures like the Mary Rose ship, which when are removed from the water where they have sunk over hundreds of years ago, the wood starts to shrink and twist and warp and break, and we need to avoid that, and therefore impregnating them with polymers can introduce some durability as well as dimensional stability. And then we also work at the macro scale, particularly with engineered timbers, to look at the design and construction of buildings and schools and other structures in which we need to live, work, and be treated in, for example. There are a couple of YouTube videos, links up there, which you can look at if you want to know a bit more about our range of research. The wood welding work that we have done with the TWI started off a couple of years ago now. And my colleagues, Dr. Eleni Tumpanaki, who's now a lecturer at the University of Bristol, as well as Dr. Tom Reynolds, who is now a lecturer at the University of Edinburgh, are also involved in this project. Our primary interests lie with engineered timber, and this is not your ordinary timber that you can get from B&Q, for example. It's structural timber that you would use for mass construction. An example of an engineered timber is, for example, cross-laminated timber, in which you have, if you can see a sample over here in the right light, you have number of layers of sawn wood that are glued together at 0-90 degrees, and you can produce these at large scale, and there are a couple of companies, firms, large firms that we work and collaborate with, such as Stora Enso, who produce CLT panels several meters long for use in floors as walls, for modular construction, prefabricated construction, amongst many other methods of construction. The main ideas we want to get across is that buildings are or can be carbon sinks rather than just carbon emitters. The building and construction industry, not only in the UK, but also globally, is responsible for 30 to 40% of global carbon emissions, as well as energy consumption, as well as solid waste, actually. And concrete is one of the biggest culprits for this, and we should be using plant-based materials like timber, which are the only significant material that are grown and are renewable. In fact, the word material itself derives from the Latin materia, which means the trunk of a tree. And this is a material that we have been working with for thousands of years, and still we are learning new technologies with it. Each kilogram of timber stores 1.6 to 1.8 kilograms of carbon dioxide, and hence goes on to show again the opportunity to use it for long span applications or long-term applications, particularly because 50% of globally harvested timbers are used straight away for fuel wood. And rather than burning this valuable resource for energy recovery, we should be using it for longer term applications, longer lifespan applications, and then thinking of other alternative end of life routes. Deforestation is a concern, but we should note that, for example, Europe's forest cover is growing, and a lot of other continents are afforesting quite rapidly. Biodiversity and managing the biodiversity in our forests and the numbers of our forest area, as well as how much valuable resource we can get from it, is important. But nonetheless, engineered timbers like CLT, LVL, laminated veneer lumber, in which we have thin veneers of timbers that are glued together all in the same grain direction to provide substantial strength, are also useful in such building applications. A three-bedroom apartment that were to be made from engineered timber would require 15 trees. Now, if you think in comparison, in the UK, for example, an average person uses about 8 to 10 trees per year just for paper. And these three-bedroom apartments would be designed for at least 50 to 70 years and probably survive even longer. So there is a lot of value for us to get from using these plant-based materials for the construction sector, not only for sustainability, but also for rapid construction and cheaper construction. Moving on from this, there are a number of challenges that we need to overcome if we are to explore the construction of timber, especially innovating with it, for example, to create taller buildings. We, for example, have worked with a number of engineering and architectural firms such as this design, concept design with Perkins and Will and Thornton Tomasetti, the River Beach Tower in Chicago, which is designed to be 240 meters tall. And it uses a combination of glulam, LVL, and CLT. One of the challenges with these sorts of designs is the connections, because the connections, how different components, for example, walls and floors, how they connect to each other are the weak points. And therefore, we need to either understand how we can strengthen these or make them more durable. Often these joints are using metallic fasteners, for example, or using polymer adhesives or composites, for example, glued in rod, CFRP or GFRP materials. The other challenge is also fire. And although wood burns at a known rate and the charring rate is constant, what tends to happen in an engineered material such as CLT is that once the once the fire has progressed into the material and it reaches a glue line, the layer delaminates and fresh wood is exposed, and that leads to continued progress of the fire. And therefore, if we were to think of other methods of joining timbers more efficiently, that can help take this this material even further into our homes for furniture, but also for the building and construction sector. And therefore, we have been working with the TWI on this fantastic technology of wood welding. And in the next slide, there are some initial results that we have obtained. So as Kate mentioned to you, TWI themselves have tested a range of different timbers, both hardwoods and softwoods, as well as wood composites like MDF. We particularly have gone on to look at in a bit more detail into beech. So this is an example of a welded wood sample. And then if you were to break it in shear mode, you can see what the failure surface looks like. So there is some substrate failure as well as some failure along the weld line in the material. So it's a mixed mode failure, which can give quite high shear strengths. Many of these were tested at the same frequency of 75 hertz. And as Kate again mentioned, this is in the linear friction welding frequency domain. Much of the literature studies have primarily used vibration welding at much higher frequencies, sometimes exceeding 150, 200 hertz. What we have done is look at the effect of welding time on the shear strengths of the materials of the joint. We anecdotally, we observed that weld times of 1 second didn't form a bond. And we think this is because the heat generated during the friction process wasn't enough to initiate that bond. And that is primarily because one of the cell wall polymers in wood is lignin, and that is a thermoplastic, and it starts to melt and flow after a certain temperature, and a weld's time of 1 second would not have possibly reached that temperature. However, weld times of 2 and 3 seconds give really high shear strength values in the range between 13 to 15 megapascals. And the very exciting thing is that this exceeds or is at least comparable to the shear capacity of beech itself. So the bond, the weld that we create is stronger than the wood itself, which is a dream for any material scientist. At higher weld times of 5 and 7 seconds, we see a dramatic fall in the shear strength of less than 5 megapascals. And this may be because at higher weld times, the heat generated is, the temperature reached is much higher, leading to degradation, probably thermal and mechanical, of lignin and other cell wall polymers, and therefore the weld shear strength is much lower. We also see, based on our microscopy results, that, and there are a couple of micrographs on the slide over there, that higher weld times, the weld line has much more porosity, and higher porosity often leads to, has a detrimental effect on the shear strength. In the next slide, we've also tried to compare some of our results with those in literature. I move the slide. Perfect. Thanks, Kate. And as you can see, our results compare quite favorably in comparison to those in literature. The weld times of 2 and 3 seconds give a shear strength of 13 to 15 megapascals, and that is substantially higher than what has been reported in literature. And as I mentioned, that's primarily because we have been applying this technique using linear friction welding rather than vibration friction welding, which has been primarily looked at in literature. But nonetheless, you tend to see this interesting profile of how weld time affects the shear strength in the bond line. And weld time so far is the only parameter that we have changed or much more systematically changed. There are lots of opportunities to not only change weld time, but also the pressure with which you're putting together the beech samples, for example, as well as the vibration amplitude, and the frequency of vibration. And we would be interested in looking at how all of these come together and how they can be optimized to give possibly even higher shear strengths. Wouldn't that be amazing? There are some micrographs of failure surfaces again. You can see the different brittle and ductile failure surfaces at higher weld times. It's a very smooth and shiny surface, which is characteristic of the low shear strength. And whereas weld times of 2 and 3 seconds, you can see some substrate failure and lots of shear failure in the wood itself, and not too dissimilar from the native timber. And again, that compares well with our numerical measurements. And I think I pass on to Nick, who will describe a bit further on what the advantages and disadvantages of this technique are.
Right, and didn't make the fatal error of not unmuting my microphone, I'm pleased to say. Thank you, Darshil. Thank you, Kate. Fascinating presentations, really informative, and hopefully the people on the webinar can start to really see the potential benefits. And I think more importantly as well, that the potential applications that we could aim for with these processes on this process. It's something we're very, very excited about at TWI. I mean, really, Darshil's touched upon some environmental benefits there that we've highlighted. production benefits, you know, as Kate has suggested, potentially an incredibly fast process. You know, the cycle time of the bond is 2 to 3 seconds, and as we can see from Darshil's slides, we've seen very, very promising results with faster cycle times. You know, the process has the potential to be fully automated. You know, we're not dealing with any curing times or anything like that. It is a very, very repeatable process, and we know that because of the, you know, as we said at the beginning, it is an established process. It's a mature process. And as Kate highlighted, it's used in very, very safe to critical applications, applications where these components need to be very, very accurate, and they're subject to very, very harsh conditions. So we're really, really excited about the potential of the process, the potential applications which we hope you're going to pass back to us. Kate, can I ask you to move on to the next slide, please? So we've really tried to highlight here the development phases. I mean, to be honest, we've done the first section there, where we've done the preliminary trials. We've worked with some different materials. We've looked at the parameters of force and time, etc. And really, this phase is the industry awareness phase. So this is really where we're pushing it out to industry, and we're saying, you know, we have this technology, we have this idea that this could really be good in industry. What can you bring to us in terms of applications? So really the next phase is this research and development phase is really where industry plays its part, where hopefully you can see the potential in the process, and you can come back to us with some applications that we can start to look at. We can tell you whether we think it's a viable application, and then we can obviously look at partnering with you and moving the process forward. And eventually that, hopefully, if everything is successful, it leads to industrialization. And again, as I touched upon in the beginning, and I believe in fact on this webinar today, I think there will be some of our members that are in fact machinery manufacturers. So, you know, we are confident if we find an application and the process is right for the application, that we can then also help with the technology transfer, moving you into industrialization, into having a machine and carrying out this welding yourself. Thank you, Kate.
Nick, may I also mention that we also have studentships. TWI is supporting two students at the University of Cambridge, who will be working on a year-long project on wood welding and looking at a range of different types of woods, for example.
Thank you, Darshil. Yeah, much appreciated. That's good. Thanks, Kate. To summarize, you know, hopefully we've illustrated that TWI have this heritage in looking at processes, in developing processes, in working with our members to hopefully take ideas from conception right the way through to inception right the way through to a manufactured product. You know, we like to say that we know the materials, we know the joining processes, and hopefully we can then help you adopt those joining processes. I think it's been a pleasure to work with Darshil and the University of Cambridge on this. I think everybody's aware that they have, as it says, the highest standards in academia. And Darshil and his team obviously have also a deep knowledge of the natural materials as well. So thank you very much for your participation in this, and it's very good to work with you. So what we'd like to do is we've got quite a few questions, I think. Sorry, Kate, if you can go back to that other slide, that'd be great. So we've got quite a few questions that have come in. And I'm going to take a look at a few of those questions here. We've a limited amount of time. So as I said at the beginning, what I would suggest is we'll address a few of the questions, but rest assured we've logged all of these questions. We have your contact details from your registration, and we will get back to you. We will get back to you with that as well. Right, so just bear with me a minute. Okay. So I've got one here, which is, what is the influence of water content of the wood on the process? So I don't know, Darshil, would you like to touch upon that one?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. The moisture content of the timber has an effect on the bond performance, both in terms of what the water moisture content is prior to the application process, as well as in service, the effects it may have on the actual bond. Some literature suggests, for example, that friction welding or vibration welding of drier wood results in higher shear strengths. So far, we have conducted our tests in a humidity-controlled environment in which we know the moisture content, the equilibrium moisture content of our samples. It's in the range of 10 to 12%. And that is often the equilibrium moisture content of engineered timbers in the building sector, ranging between 8 to 12%. Of course, because of the heat generated and the temperatures involved during even that short time span in the heat affected zone, so to speak, or at the bond line, some of the moisture might evaporate, or it may start to depolymerize some of the polymers in the cell wall and therefore facilitate even the bond performance. But it is something we need to explore in a bit more detail through more control tests, as well as looking at the aging performance of these bonds.
Fantastic. Thank you, Darshil. I've seen one question here which relates to, is there any sort of surface preparation required for the two pieces of wood to be welded? Kate, would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, so at the moment, we don't do any particularly special surface preparation. Even when we're joining other materials like metal, we'll machine that surface. But there's not any edge preparation like there would be in a manual arc welding process or another welding process. So at the moment, we've not done anything to the surface of the wood. We've literally just cut it. But we are interested to look into what effect applying something like lignin to the surface might have on the characteristics of the bond. But at the moment, yeah, it's literally just cut and then joined together.
Great, okay. I've got another one here, which I'm gonna throw at you guys, which is, have there been any tests or results from softwoods like pine? I think we'll throw that one probably over to Darshil. Have you seen any?
Yeah. I think TWI have run some tests on softwoods, not on pine, but they have run on fir and larch, I think. And we are still not entirely sure what makes this happen, in the sense, even though there are a wide variety of species of trees, and each species would have a different combination of cell wall polymers, for example, lignin content, and even the lignin is different in the different species. And therefore, trying to better understand how biochemical composition relates to the bond performance is something we're interested in doing. So as part of the studentships, the two students that will be working with TWI and ourselves will be looking at, for example, one softwood, spruce, for example, which is commonly used for cross-laminated timber, as well as beech, because we want to further this research. Beech is also used in laminated veneer lumber in Europe, for example. And we also want to look at bamboo. Bamboo is a fascinating material that we with, and it is a grass, which is not a wood actually, and trying to understand how the sugars as well as the starches and lignin influence the bond performance would be interesting for us to know.
Fantastic. We've got a great number of questions, I'm delighted to say. I think we're running out of time on the webinar now as well, so we will be answering some of these after the webinar, but rest assured, anything that's been raised in there, we will be getting back to you. There's one further question, which I think is quite an interesting one, is can dissimilar types of woods or timbers be joined? Who wants to take that one?
I guess I'll take that for now and then.
Okay.
Darshil. So again, it's not something that we've tried at the minute. We're still in initial phases of testing, and we'd love to get someone on board that wants to try to join dissimilar wood. It is a technique that's used to join dissimilar materials, and it's known for being very good at that within the industry. So it's often used for joining steel to aluminium, for instance, and we've also done some trials joining thermo plastics to composite materials, and thermo sets using a thermoplastic interlayer to composite materials. So we've tried it on other materials using dissimilar things, and it's worked very well. It's known for working really well, but onward we haven't tried that yet, but we'd be really keen to give it a go if someone wanted to come on board and try that with us. I don't know if Darshil, if you have any additional technical comments on that.
No, I think that's entirely right. It's quite, our hypothesis would be yes, it should be able to, especially if you have one material that has, for example, a higher polymer or a lignin content, for example, to facilitate that sort of bonding. There's also a couple of questions whether you can join weld woods in different grain directions, and we have. We have done these on parallel, perpendicular to grain, as well as end grain to end grain. The performance is different, and therefore, for example, end grain to end grain tends to result in inferior properties in comparison to parallel to grain joints. And therefore, it would be interesting also to look at how we may have to tailor, we may have to select a specific end grain wood to another parallel grain wood, for example.
Yeah, just on that note, this oak sample, this is welded end to end, and that's given us really good results. But most of the other work that we've done has been with the grain rather than end to end.
Excellent, good. Well, on that note, I guess, as I said, I'll just repeat the fact that if, don't be disappointed if we haven't answered your question just yet. We certainly will get around to answering your questions as quickly as we can. I'd like to thank you for taking the time to join the webinar. I hope you found it as fascinating as I did. And on behalf of TWI and the University of Cambridge, we'd love to look at your potential applications. We've put some email addresses up on there that you can contact either us at the TWI or Darshil at the University of Cambridge. Feel free to do so as well. We welcome any dialogue, reference the webinar, and in fact, any of the points that you want to discuss with us. So I think we'll sign off now. Thank you very much indeed. Thanks for your time. See you all soon.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Nick.
Thank you,
Stacey. Thank you. For